Welcome back to my Pandora Draft Breakdown. In this video, I put my drafting skills to the test and play several matches with my Pandora deck. Be sure to check out part 1 if you missed it, as it goes through the entire deck building process. So sit back, relax, and enjoy some Pandora action. Battletoads is brilliant. We'll just throw these two. Gives us an early collector. Okay, so we don't have Tyrannax this time. We have only 2/2s. We'll see how it plays out. Now, starting in the middle is a good line for a mid-range deck, but it is quite weak to a rush deck. Now, in Constructed, I wouldn't usually go this way unless I was playing Gathering Archons or Windstorm Charges. So, yellow events, yellow control, blue sevens, or maybe a blue sevens Reaver deck or something like that, because I want to be able to zip my charge creatures around the well spots with their charge 2 mechanic. Against rush players, you don't want to take this land. You want them to build this land because it costs them a resource from their power wheel. So I'm going to show you a different kind of land placement. So if you wanted to avoid running into a rush deck, you can build your land in a very specific way as a mid-range deck. So I'll show you how you can do it. There's two ways, actually. We did see one of the players in the previous game do it. He went land here, here, and here. Now, this formation was invented, I believe, by the Faeria Tale guys, Imperia Mayhem, Mayhem being a monthly cup champion. And the whole purpose of that land placement was to stop Silent Horse Masters gaining access to structures on this tile. So if you build up like this, a horse master could send a creature up, and then he can't get to this spot, which means he can't get a structure. But there's also just building along the wells, and that works too. So I can go lake. I'll pass this. I don't want to play the Queen's Assassin as a collector. I'd rather use her to clear a creature. And against red, Queen's Assassin's not as useful, unfortunately. So yeah, I go lake. Explore Lake Battletoads. But there's also a different line I can take, a more controlling line, where you go Lake Battletoads, and then on the next turn you go like neutral, and then you can collect. Okay, this is very odd. Oh, he's playing the Rebel Glider, so I kind of regret not playing the Assassin here. And if I use the Explore, I don't get to play the Darkstalker because I don't have enough land. So let's just do this. So now we're blocking all the land, so he can't move onto my land and generate an aggressive land. That's the plan here. This is a different style of aggro play. We've seen this before in monthly cups. The players have opted to go down the side of their wells instead of the front. But we'll see what this Rebel Glider gets up to. You might just push face. The one advantage this land placement gives from a Battletoad is he can jump on here and I can make a lake right by here. So I don't even have to double neutral up. So his best line is to just clear this guy, I think. I'm certain you just clear this guy somehow if you don't have the removal, because jumping here lake is pretty dangerous for him. It gives me a collection spot which I can summon my blue creatures on, and then it pushes me closer to his orb. He doesn't know what to do. I have the Falcon Dive as well, which is good. I can, if he takes out a frog, I just drop the Falcon Dive down. Oh, Blazing Salamander, evil. But I'm okay with that. I think that's fine because I one shot this, I Falcon Dive, and I can play a Darkstalker down. I'm going to stop his aggressive lands instead of pushing lands out myself. We'll play it here to play around Bombslinger. If I played it here, he can mount in there and just Bombslinger me. Or mount in here and just Bombslinger me from this side. And next turn we have Queen's Guard, so if anything too aggressive comes down, we do have a way to stall. And this guy will gain Faeria for us if he initiates combat. We're in a red deck, that's quite likely to happen, since they don't have hard removal or any transform effects. What's he considering? Four Faeria is not a lot to work with. This little hand, if you see the cards kind of shuffling along, this usually indicates that they might be a little frustrated. That's the read I usually get. Okay, so Bloodstone Sprite. That's fine. And the four health's a little frustrating because now the Queen's Guard doesn't one-shot it. So if I pick up an enchantment, I'll be very happy. We see him going for Faeria. That might indicate to me he already has a play lined up for next turn. You generally take Faeria if you're trying to play something next turn or you're just trying to keep your economy intact. Now, Herald is a better line because it does clear this, but the problem I have is I'd have to lake here. I'd have to lake here and not collect to protect my Darkstalk. And I want to keep this alive as long as possible. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to double neutral now. And I'm going to double neutral up the center. Because if I double up neutral up this side, he just takes this spot. And then there's just no point in doing that because I'll lose this spot guaranteed. If I double neutral up the center, he has to go along here to stop me. Actually, I don't know if I want to do that. I think I might just draw instead. I don't really need the aggression right now. Pandora. Okay. That's actually not bad. Because if he doesn't make the attack and the Steamforge powers up my Queen's Guard or my Darkstalker, I can kill this in one hit. Which is what I wanted to achieve. And Steamforge is actually one of my better draws, I think, in this specific situation. Because I didn't want to play Herald because he could just clear my Darkstalker and then my Herald loses 4 health anyway. He might take the preemptive hit. And then, depending on what gets buffed, I'll just clear with what's left. Gift of Steel? Flame Burst? Or maybe he's just figuring out what these cards can do together. He must be struggling with this. Unless he's just deciding what he wants to clear. Bombslinger? No, just a Fire Elemental. So now the best draw for us is the Punishment. Or a buff onto that guy there. That's pretty good too. So now I can do this. Move. Clear this guy. Trade these off. Plus one. Ancient Herald. So I have a really strong defense now. And he's starved of Faeria. I could even move onto this spot and just lake here and then get that good lake on his well. So whenever I summon an aggressive creature, he's going to start collecting Faeria for me. He's made an arrow with his lands. It's pretty funny. So in Constructed, you would probably expect Scyther's Wrath to come on this guy. And this just be removed. But in Pandora, not as likely. He would need to actually find Scyther's Raft in his card selection and then choose it over something else. What's he doing? He seems to be struggling a bit. If he plays any creature with less than 5 health, my Herald will kill it, and I'll keep this guy alive. Because it's more important to have multiple creatures on board. Unless I want to play around Firestorm. That could be a factor. We'll see. The clock is ticking. I don't think he has a play. So he takes the draw. Axe Grinder. Okay. So we can't play Firestorm next turn. So I think I just take the value clear. And take that leak I was talking about. Alright, so I'm very vulnerable to Firestorm now. But I kind of have a feeling he doesn't have it. Like I said, you'd have to find it in his draft, in his card pool, and then draft it over any other options. You might have had better options. I could have played around it, but I'll see if I get punished. I might do. He still needs an extra turn. If he passes without playing anything this turn, I could maybe suspect a Firestorm. For me, his best use of the power wheel is a draw or a Faeria, because it gives me this lake, which is going to be very important. His best defensive lands are probably neutral, but I can still move over and take lake here if I want aggression. But I don't get the Faeria and the orb hit from that spot. From this spot here, I gain Faeria when my creature becomes active, and then I get the push damage if I can. So he takes Faeria, okay. Pretty good. Outland Ranger would be pretty good. It could power this up beyond Firestorm. Alright, so take this. We'll move. And I'll play the Queen's Faeria. If this was any other creature that didn't have more than 3 health, I wouldn't play it. But I'm only playing this now because if he does Firestorm, this stays alive unless he +1 Cypher's Wraths as well. And it continues to collect Faeria for me. And from now on, I can just draw cards and gain Faeria. I don't need to produce any more lands. I might have to produce defensive lands if he pushes lands over here. But if he's spending time trying to build, say, like a mountain here or a mountain here, I'm already putting on a lot of pressure. just waiting for him to react to me now. He could Hellfire. Hellfire would be pretty good. But hopefully my Steamforge would just soak up most of that. And my Orb. I would like my Orb and Steamforge to just completely soak the Hellfire and then maybe leave a couple of these on 1 health and that'd be absolutely fine. If he plays a threat, I have Humbling Visions, which is nice. Could go like +1 into Ogre Battler here to protect himself, and I can go Humbling Visions clear, and then I get to push 4 damage. Maybe he's saving up for Meteor. Oh, that Salamander! Another one! That was beautiful. That was absolutely perfect for him. Alright, Spell Will first. Let's see what we get. Really? I already said how useless these cards are when I drafted them. And now I have 2 more of them. It's not very nice. Alright, we get Pandora. That's nice. It's going to give us the additional Faeria for Pandora. Oh, so good. I'm just going to play these to buff this up. So that's all those... Actually, the failed experiments worked out pretty nicely in that situation just because I gained additional power. I could have hammered face and set it up lethal, but If he clears my turtle, I only have the queen's favorite left. Actually, maybe Hammer Face is a little better. Flame Burst, my Steam Forge. Eight fairy. He has a lot of fairy to work with. He could set up a big taunt like Ogre Battler. But I have Humbling Visions, which is going to be great for that. He takes the draw, which means he can't play a red creature here. Oh, he has a hammer of his own. And what's this, a flame spear? Oh my goodness. He had the answer. That's not a good draw for us. That's not a good draw either. Yeah, that's pretty bad. I'll play the shell here to replace the Queen's Favorite as a collector, then I'll start pushing the Queen's Favorite up. To be fair though, if the shell starts getting hit by the Steam Forge, he could be quite useful. He is locked into this position, unfortunately. But he can move here into double collection, and then it forces the opponent to build land to stop me from double collecting. I have so much Faeria, but I don't have any cards. Where he has a good amount of cards and a good amount of Faeria, so there's a lot more he can do. I need to start drawing into my... Well, my bigger creatures have been used, mainly. My Queen's Guard, my Ancient Herald. So now I want to draw into my Tyranax, my Snowstorm Lancer. Those are the two cards I'll be wanting to find in my next few draws. Oh, he's not sure what to do. I'm assuming he just doesn't have any more removal. He's had two Blazing Salamanders already. I didn't play around the Blazing Salamander. It's not a very popular card in Constructed, so I'm not too used to it. And there's the Ogre Battler. I knew he'd show up eventually. And plus one. This is a perfect trade-off for us. All right, let's take the draw. Banquet. So I'm going to take the Frogify. I'll move this guy up. And then I'm going to guard here instead. And then just pass. Like I want this guy to get hit by Banquet next turn so I can push 5 damage. And his next big threat we have Humbling Visions for. As for treasures, we don't want Dark Crystal just yet. It's not necessary. We don't need a board wipe. We need the lamp. The lamp would help so much right now because I'm starved for cards. I'm picking up a lot of my events, my smaller creatures. I've used a lot of my bulky ones. So this is where Jin's lamp can become very useful. Just recharging your hand, gaining some new cards. It is random, so it can be a little awkward if you pick up a bunch of events. Oh, he does have the firebomb. Okay. So I assume he's just going to clear this. This sturdy shell's useless now. Unless he gets powered up by Steamforge. I could give him Banquet. Actually, I could give him Banquet and jump him here. And then jump him here. That's a bit daft. There he is. Where have you been all my life? Okay. So, I could set up Lethal with the Banquet now. So I play Tyranax. I play Banquet. I hop here. And that's Lethal with the Hammer. Because I'll get a buff from the Steamforge. Taking us up to 7 power. And then 3, 2, 12 damage exactly. But if he takes a land here, I can't go face. Which is going to be really sad. But we'll see if he spots it. As long as he doesn't play any taunts, I should be okay. should be able to spot, find a lethal next turn. And he needs to take the slant. He needs to see that I have a setup for next turn. And he might not spot it. Oh, he's hovering. Oh, he turned that into a mountain. Okay. Another ogre battler? Yeah, figured as much. But we do have Humbling Vision at least. Wait a minute. I don't think there's a player with profit. No, we're too landlocked. Ninja Toad? Humbling Visions. Throw the hammer here. Jump. So as long as one of these survive, I can get lethal next turn. Look how much reach my Steady Shell has. He can go anywhere he wants apart from mountains, but ocean, lakes, not a problem. I think it's going to be very hard for him to stop this lethal now. Let's say he kills this and it costs him all his Faeria. I can still just Ninja Toad and swing. And even if I don't find the lethal with Ninja Toad next turn, and this gets removed, as long as this gets... Well, if this gets removed, this will get buffed by the Steamforge. And then Sturdy Shell is lethal on his own, not including Ninja Toad. So I'm in the position to win. It's going to be very hard for me to lose at this point. But we've already seen two Ogre Battlers. He's going to rely on another Taunt. Or maybe like Double Flame Burst, Firebomb Cyphers, Bomb Slinger. Oh, he picks up a treasure. That could be what he needs. Like a dark... No, he can't afford Dark Crystal. And it's not going to be enough. He has the hammer. Does he have the one damage for it? He does! Hammer Flame Burst! Good old 8 damage to Tyranax here. Give our friend a well played here. Aha! And there we have it. Another victory in the bag with this deck. Angiwork. Oh, wow. Okay, so this is going to be probably the most challenging game I've had so far. Engi qualified for the Battle of the Gods tournament. So he knows what's up. You know, a top 10 god player. Explore with Battletoads is really nice. That's a little greetings from our friend there. I'm going to go on the opposite side since he's green. I'll see what he does, actually. You don't need to play Explore straight away. So he's already committed 2 lands this side, so we can just go up this side instead. So this is a good setup, because now, next turn, I can either double neutral up here to double collect, or double neutral across this way to double collect. And as we can see, we've seen a side switch come in from Engi here. Knowing that he does need to challenge me. And a Grove Guardian. So that makes my double collection up this way a lot worse. Unless I draw a Frogify. Okay, so we're going to do this. So this is a safe position. Unless he has some form of land manipulation. I mean, no, I actually don't think Mono Green can get to me at this point. Not even a teleport, because he needs a forest. So he needs to go like forest, wood elemental, forest, Sagami, Grove Caller, teleport clear. And then next turn, so if I play, actually, if I play Tyranax here, next turn I go for Frogify Tritons. Or I could even avoid the Frogify this turn. I might keep this for later, because Tritons on my Tyranax is going to make him a bit bulkier. And these two alone can clear the Grove Guardian. And just playing a healer just to gain additional Faeria. The heal not really meaning much at the moment. So hit first, because if we move this guy first, we wouldn't have enough room for the Tyrannax to be able to move in. I'll take the Queen's Guard behind him. So if he has, say, Cypher's Wrath, we could still collect from this well and then jump this frog over here. The only reason I haven't jumped him over yet is because it made no difference. The fairy had already been collected. We see a defensive mountain coming from our friend here. Ooh, that's very nice. I might do that immediately just so I... Well, no, actually, I'd like to keep that as a surprise. So, yeah, we get to collect. We could actually play a less aggressive now. But I don't think it makes a difference. Like, as much as I would love this frog to start collecting this side, I do miss a collection here. But you know what we could do? Oh, we play into Firestorm. Let's see how he responds to it. So I have tri-collection going on there. And that just shows how powerful Battletoads are. They're just very good at collecting Faeria, just causing mischief. You get a clean trade-off if you frogify something. I'd be very concerned if a Warstorm turned up there. He's going to take Faeria, so its quality of hand is pretty good. So I know that already. Let's take the aggressive lake while we can. I'll take the draw first. Let's see what the draw finds us. Okay. So I've bumped this up to 6. A bit preemptive there, probably. I could have waited, but I don't have a target in my hand, which is better than Queen's Guard. Goes for the draw, so perhaps doesn't have the answer he needs right now. Wood Elemental. Not the best. And an Elderwood Embrace. So our Frogify is gone. There's no more transform effects for us. Falcon Dive doesn't help. I'm going to take a draw. We don't need any land. Campfire doesn't help either. Well, Campfire allows a clean clear on this with the Falcon Dive. So I can do this. So I move. Retreat this guy because we don't want him to get killed by the Tiki Healer. Play the Outland Ranger. Well, actually, the frog is a bit better because it can hit the orb next turn. So let's play the Outland Ranger here. Falcon Dive. There we go. So this is a little vulnerable to a buff on the healer, but it means he has to make land by there, and he's not drawing cards or gaining Faeria. So I'm fine with that, because these two frogs can just... If this is an Elderwood Embrace, it's a bit more difficult, but if it's just a +2/+2 buff, these two frogs can clear this if it moves. The Elderwood Embrace, he had to have it. So now what do I need? Not a Sturdy Shell. Pandora Hammer? Oh, Lamp. Cool. That's his first time using Lamp, so let's see what we get. Rubyfish, Spellwill, and Wisp. Not the best, unfortunately. Alright, hopefully Spellwill will give us something worthwhile. Nope. Well, this is not bad, actually, because now Failed Experiment has more use. This is just a free-free. Nothing more. So we can now start moving our forces up and applying pressure. I'm going to stick Sturdy Shell here. And play the Wisp here. And just push 2 this turn. So the sturdy shell is just acting as a blocker for the healer. The healer can't kill the sturdy shell yet. So I'm just trying to make his life as difficult as possible while we try and finish this game off. I don't think we can win a long game now. I was kind of hoping he didn't have the Elderwood Embrace. Ancient Beastmaster into Willow. 2-8, that's pretty annoying. More Battletoads. Let's kill this. Well, he can't do anything. I could start setting up this disciple. Play him here, play Battletoads. Then again, I don't want him too close to the combat yet. I want him to build up over time, so maybe he's better off in this spot. I do have Stormspawn next turn. That could fight on board for me. Yeah, I think I'm going to pass on this. He doesn't clear the Wisp with the Willow. He moves here, clears the shell, and then this moves here and blocks the Wisp. Yeah, things are starting to get a bit awkward now. Oh, that's Caretaker. So many buffs. Powerful. He's stabilized. It's not very helpful. Could do with another treasure. Oh, double disciple. Let's play the Stormspawn this turn. And then we'll pass. So we want to play disciples when we have events in hand to use. Since he's playing red, we want to play around the removal. That's the most important thing right now. Oh, I hope this isn't a Verdant Force. Been a bit of trouble if it is. Could be a teleport. So got me worried. That's pretty lenient. I'm gonna continue buffing this Willow. He's giving us our lake back. That's very kind of him. Alright, spell Will first. Let's see what we get. Again, nothing that great. That's the problem with spell Will. So it's very hit or miss. I'll take the draw. Try and get a treasure. It's not a treasure. So these two can clear the Willow. But I just don't have anything worthwhile setting up yet. Maybe I try and bait him to clear the Egg of Wonder. Because Egg of Wonder is not going to find me anything useful. Just trying to think of a good line here. There just doesn't seem to be any. Well, actually, wait a minute. No, that's not going to work. I was thinking Lake here, Disciple, and then Battletoads, but I can't do it. All right, we're gonna do this. It's not very good though. I didn't get my Steam Forge down. I ran out of time. It's such a hard turn because I don't have anything that proactive going on. And I know I'm going to lose a later game because this deck doesn't pack any real late game threats like Oak Father. And I've used my Frogify. I should have played him there. It's a bit of a misplay from me there. And getting the Steamforge down was important. I set up this frog to clear this guy. That was the plan. Herald, that's not bad. Ooh, crystal. Alright, so we can move here. Play turtle, crystal. Push two? Oh, we might be back in this actually. Gonna play Rubyfish here to block him so he can't move along and then summon another creature. And the hammer. Oh, this might be able to. I might be able to win this. I'm so shocked. Like, I thought this was lost. I honestly did. Let's see if he has a. He might have a dark crystal of his own now. Fire some. Ah, no. No. 7 damage. So hammer, draw hammer. Is that what I'm going for now? Oh my goodness. I could just go for Herald. Harold's tanky. Harold should live. Oh man, what am I doing here? Am I going for the cheese and just going hammer, draw and try and get the hammer in the next two turns? Or do I go for Harold? But if he plays a taunt, I'm gonna lose. Yeah, if he plays a taunt, I've lost. If there was less lands about, I could play. I'm going to go for it, guys. It has to happen. But then again, how many cards do I have in hand? I can just play Failed Experiment as well. Hammer. Giving me time. So now I'm all in on a hammer win. I have 8 cards. It's back in the deck. I get 2 draws next turn. This should buy me some time. Oh my goodness. No, the healer. Why heal? And the doom scythe. Oh my goodness. Oh no, I could have went for Herald plus 1 Steamforge as an alternative. I didn't draw the hammer anyway. Good games. Well played. And there we have it. So that concludes the Pandora Draft Breakdown. Pandora is a fun and exciting way to play Faeria, so be sure to try it out.